Welcome everybody to the next session of Black Tech Fest. I am delighted today to be joined by someone who's more exceptional than me in every single way. Yes, I was delighted to meet our guest here, Jasmine, on a lovely island in the middle of the Pacific. And immediately from the moment we spoke, we were like, we need to find a way to bring the synergy together. But such is the power that we have in the technology ecosystem. We can be about 5.5 thousand miles away, further away from any of you probably at all as well. But we're still able to make that happen. But that's probably as much as I can explain about how we make that happen. But we do have someone on the call who can do a lot more than that. So if I give the really short introduction, Jasmine is an entrepreneur, both people, product, person, manager, a business owner slash, I suppose that is an entrepreneur, an expert in everything to do with hardware, software, and the things in between. She has worked for a number of amazing companies, chasing anything from moonshots to the moon, and in between. But I'm still butchering the introduction. So Jasmine, let's jump straight in. Can you tell everybody why they should be as in awe of you as I am?
First, I'll say thank you so much, Ashley. When we met during the residency in Bermuda, we just absolutely hit it off. And what I noted is, you know, the connection between us is our commitment to advancing people of color in STEM. When I heard of the work that you were doing, I was like, I want to be a part of it. Let me know how I can show up or invest. And so thank you so much for the opportunity to connect with all these people in your audience. It's really my honor. This is what I want to be doing with my life when I am striving for excellence in my role. It's primarily to make space and be a great representative and reflection of just the Black excellence. So a little bit about me, and from an educational standpoint, I got my bachelor's in computer science at Georgia Tech and my master's in human-centered design and engineering at the University of Washington. I followed that up quickly during the pandemic with a certificate in women's entrepreneurship from Cornell. But how have I actually leveraged that education? Well, it started with starting my own company at the age of 13, a company called Eden Body Works that makes natural hair and body care products for women of color with curly hair. My goal was to create natural, affordable, and effective solutions for taking care of your curls, because I really do believe that the way that you look and when you love and embrace your own personal value, that can unlock so much for you, especially in your career, in your relationships, and just in your life in general. On the tech side, as Ashley mentioned, I've worked for a number of tech companies creating anything from consumer electronics to robots to help you in your everyday life. And it's just my honor, my privilege to use the work that I do to serve different communities. I love it.
So that's amazing. And again, you've been very humble in that. So, I mean, if we don't jump to it through this conversation, we'll just do a roll call of your list of achievements.
You know, I'm fine with it. I'm fine if you want to brag on me. What I want to do is try and use as much of this time to support those other people who are wanting to pursue product management. But yeah, definitely check out my website. I'm a badass, I promise.
Well, let's get straight into that. So tell me, because You kind of started the other way around, actually. You spoke a bit about your education, but then you said at 13 you started your first organization, your first business. And then how do you make the jump from curly hair to robots? Like, help us understand that, navigating that pathway.
That's a great question. And you know, one of the things that I did want to share as a pro tip for product managers is that there's so much value in being an entrepreneur or in just strictly having an entrepreneurial mindset when you're going to, you know, making products, whether they're technical or hardware, software, or whatever they happen to be. For me, I saw a need, and that need actually came from losing my own hair to a relaxer. I didn't feel beautiful anymore, and that really felt like it put a block between what I could achieve and what I could accomplish. Not just if society would accept me, but my own kind of self-esteem was really diminished from losing that. And so in talking to other people, and my sisters and my family, I recognized, like, I'm not the only person who's had a bad hair day and really felt like they don't want to leave the house. It can be crippling for women at times to live up to the social standards that exist. So I started doing research and, you know, going to, you know, physically going to the library, because this was like 20 years ago, and just trying to find natural oils and herbs and spices that I could use to heal my scalp and take care of my hair. And after attending a business camp hosted by the Network for Teaching Entrepreneurship, I learned that starting a business is a great way to get that product out there and to meet needs that you see in your community. Specifically, I wanted to support women who were growing their hair naturally and just to embrace their kinks and curls, no matter how long or short or dark or light their hair ended up being. And that's kind of how Eden Body Works was born. When I was 8 years old, I saw a movie called Bicentennial Man, and it was about this robot that was living with his family, and it just showed this vision of the future. And I was like, that's what I want to do. I want to make that. I didn't know how I was going to get to making that or participating in creating that future, but I knew from a very early age that that's what I wanted to invest in. And so went off to school, Googled entrepreneur or engineer, found the right place where it was a good fit for me to kind of lean into that. And I recognized that those same traits of like figuring out what a user need are, doing research on different options and different technologies and putting those together in practice to try and quantify and solve a specific problem were things that I already knew how to do from starting my own business. Some of the differentiators in being an entrepreneur and being a product manager for me was just like taking that perspective of leadership. I'm not the boss, I'm not in charge. I can't make all of the decisions, but what I can do is rally my team together around those business goals, around those user needs, really be an advocate and get the solutions out there, test them, try them out. It's been a really exciting journey, really sharing learnings between these two fields.
And to use like a, I suppose, a product kind of, it's almost an in joke if you say, let's double click on that. Because, there was one part of that where you like, you found, and I don't want to paraphrase incorrectly, but where effectively you could add value. But what was that journey? Because, lots of people can have great ideas, lots of people might be really organized, lots of people might think that they can contribute. But how did you navigate of all the things that you had the option to do, because you're starting at a blank state, you were earning your life, you're earning your career, many doors weren't shut. How did you navigate and understand that journey of this is where I can add a disproportionate value to the problems that I'm trying to solve? And how did you work out what you weren't going to do also? And like, how do you know to rule that out? Because I mean, that's a key part of product. You want to do
Oh, I
everything,
agree.
you can't do
I
everything.
agree. Yeah, I mean, from an engineering background, it's a lot of systems thinking, and you really have to understand what are the factors truly contributing to what's going on, and where do I really see myself kind of having that influence, right? So at the time, the price point in the market for a product was anywhere from like $15 to $30 for like one bottle of shampoo or moisturizing product, right? There was a premium on products for my community, right? And they weren't driven, originated, or motivated by people from our community, right? That was a struggle. And so for me, I had access to so many people, right, facing the concerns. And even when I did, and I did focus groups, I did research to figure out, okay, what is going on in your life? What is your workflows, we call them in the tech space, but like, what are your day-to-day rituals and habits for how you care for yourself, right? I learned from my journey of going from, regrowing my hair from scratch to, having a healthy head of hair that I felt confident about. But that was my unique journey. And while I could take some, key milestones and archetype from that journey, it was really about understanding what was going on in the market. And for me, the first thing was like, hey, let's figure out how we get your hair clean. Because from a clean scalp, that's where it starts. I'm not gonna promise you that I'm gonna help you like look like a supermodel or grow your hair down to a butt. Down your butt, but I'm gonna help you set up some basic maintenance and self-care for you that you can really invest in. And a lot of the partnerships that we did were with organizations that also wanted to invest in your self-care, in your mental health, in your self-esteem. And so we really tied ourselves with that social mission very early on to say, hey, I'm going to make some physical changes in your life, but I'm also gonna make some mental and emotional changes in your life. And you can see that really lived out and manifested through our marketing. Now, how do we know that we're having the impact that we anticipate? Well, another thing that we care a lot about in tech is data. We do a lot of surveys throughout the year to really understand the effectiveness and the impact. Like I said, we do focus groups with different textures, different lengths, different cultures, different backgrounds of hair to make sure that when we say a product is effective at doing something, it is. Now, am I running clinical trials like I'm making medicine with the FDA? Absolutely not. But we do have tons of tutorials you can see all across YouTube, tons of real-life folks writing in and saying, hey, this worked for me, it was fantastic, or hey, this didn't work, what about altering things in this way? And like I said, with that engineering background, being able to iterate and change, but also to create a diverse spread of over 50 products to serve the diversity of our community. It's not a one-size-fits-all thing.
And that's interesting. So obviously you've related a lot of that to your personal journey, your business, you know, the problem that you had. But you know, you actually started your career, if I'm not mistaken, at Xbox. So working really, really, you know, on something that wasn't your baby, so to speak. And that's not because, you know, you weren't gaming or you couldn't play or anything like that. Actually, Xbox are one of our partners, so come along and check them
Oh,
out
that's
on Thursday.
amazing.
But you know, I think from the perspective of when it's not yours, if it's not a problem that's, I suppose, you know, acutely felt to you to the point that you've got to entrepreneurship, how do you think about that product journey working on something which is, you know, a bit more removed from yourself as ultimately?
That's a great question. And honestly, when I think about when you know, one of the characteristics that I think makes a great product manager is someone that can fall in love with a problem space, with a community. I'm not saying that go be a product manager for an area you're not interested in. When you have some interest or alignment, I think that allows you to understand and pursue those problems with a bit of like a bit more curiosity and interest. So for me, I definitely was a gamer growing up. I played on my Game Boy and PlayStation and all those things. And in college is where I really kind of fell into a community of gamers where we played Xbox to like really de-stress between our coursework. But for me, there was this concept of like, oh, you're not a real gamer if you don't blank, right? If you don't play Halo, if you don't, you know, whatever. Like, hey, if you play on your mobile phone or if you play on a tablet, you're not a real gamer. And that really was a thorn in my side, right? That there was this concept that was trying to make people feel less than, and that was a similar kind of feeling that I felt, you know, when I was working in the beauty industry. And so I found opportunities, one, to combat that and to introduce social impact into the space and the things that I focused on, the way I thought about solving problems and giving people choices. And that comes from whether I was working on the system settings or whether I was working on a feature like clubs on Xbox Live, where we're building safe communities where women and kids and people who have been bullied can play without the level of harassment that they might be facing online. And so I was able to find a way to take what are the things that I love about influencing the world and what does this platform have to offer? What opportunities exist to make this product better? Working with our user research team and our design team to really isolate those problems and then lean in and brainstorm and figure out through everything that we do, how do we serve the community?
And I think from that, I think that's, and help me understand that, because I think that goes for every kind of product. You know what I mean? You're never going to find a business, a team, a product, anyone says, oh, we don't care about that segment of customer, or like, do you know what I mean? It's fine if those people don't like necessarily indulge in it. I think that's the thing. But obviously, products are all of trade-offs. You know, building for everything for everybody is impossible, really. So, you know, how do you, I suppose, think about one, you know, what decisions to make, and obviously with the lens of making sure that, you know, we don't replicate the issues that we've seen in society previously, where you've got like, you know, well, we won't build this for the disabled, or we won't build this for the black community, or we won't build this for women.
Yeah, no,
And especially, how did you think about that in a very male-dominated space to historically gaming?
absolutely. When you think about a gamer, right? And this was the energy I was feeling when I entered the space. When you think about a gamer, you have this very specific persona in mind that, you know, is this white male wearing a hoodie, you know, playing shooters in the basement of their mom's house or whatever. But that's not the only image of a gamer. There are millions of people around the world who are playing Xbox at the time, and you know, helping to make them feel seen. The team has made incredible strides in making gaming more inclusive, you know, for lots of folks. And I did actually get the opportunity to play a firsthand role in that because, like you said, as a product manager, we have the decision over which features are prioritized and what we invest in, and certain things like globalization, localization, even, right? Having the language make sense when it's translated, or even accessibility are things you can choose and choose not to prioritize because they take extra work. They take extra work is like not the great term, but when you're trying to make decisions over what you're going to invest in, for me, those are priority. For a great product manager in the 21st century, those need to be a priority. Or else you're just, honestly, you're losing market share, right? If half the planet is women and they don't see themselves as strong female leads in games, then, you know, why are they motivated to play if our stories aren't told, right? And so there's such a great opportunity there, not just on the content that is produced, but literally on the community, right? If we say, if you're being harassed, there's nothing you can do for yourself, you know, people are gonna abandon that platform and try and play somewhere where they feel like they're more safe, or never play online with other people and lose that opportunity to connect and build bridges. For me, I had the opportunity to actually go abroad to an international conference called Gamescom. At the time, it was in Germany, and I met gamers from all around the world. Who someone even like brought, physically brought their Xbox to the conference because they wanted it to be signed by all these engineers. And it was amazing to see what types of genres of games are different around the world. Like I like story-based games. I can really build empathy with different players, and you know, that exposure to different cultures really kind of opened my eyes to, okay, how can we build a platform where different stories can be told, where different people can feel safe and comfortable and connect? Because it is absolutely a choice whether or not you're gonna accommodate. And I'm not saying you have to make the platform 100%, you know, for every single person, but there's so many more larger trends in society that are just overlooked because they're outside of the range of what we would consider, I'll say, quote unquote, normal.
Got it. And at this year's Black Tech Fest, we've got a lot of different sessions. Some folks would have already heard one this morning or earlier today on diversity in the metaverse, and we've got a number of different sessions on that. Everything from embassies in the metaverse to you know, how do we make it a fair and equitable place? But you've made that transition from, I suppose, early in your career from, like, I suppose, software primarily with a little bit of hardware. You know, game is kind of a nice intersection of the two to really, I suppose, VR ultimately. And, you know, for some folks that is the metaverse in kind of like, you know, a far more tangible way. How did you, one, make that transition from doing something which was software to, I suppose, more formally hardware? And two, like, you know, doing that at a time which was, you know, not where we are today, but this was years ago. So do you know what I mean? How has that, you know, evolved? What are some of your reflections and your thoughts on that? And how did you go about that? There's lots of people who work in products and they might work on, say, an e-commerce product, but they might want to go into something which is, I don't know, fashion or gaming or
Yes,
automotive. Yeah, how do you do that?
that's a great question. So for me, the leap from gaming to AR and VR was not huge, right? Because you're still working and navigating a 3D space. There's this huge need for instructional design in AR VR so people can understand these new interaction models. And I've seen the similar challenges as people learn how to control a character walking, whether it's in 2D or in 3D, with a gamepad. For me, I was hoping to go and take my background. I study devices and artificial intelligence as my focus. So I always had that hardware background, but really finding a product where, you know, something new was happening, where the way that we use this device isn't so hard-coded and defined, was why I took the leap to jump on the Microsoft HoloLens experience team and really figure out what we could do there. For me, it was also another transition from consumer to enterprise, which is a very interesting space to see technology kind of growing and developing. That's, you know, a really great space where we've seen like the rise of computers. They didn't start in our homes, in our hands. They started in these enterprise spaces. And so being able to figure out, hey, you know, Fortune 500 company, what multi-million dollar can we solve using holograms? What could that be? That was an amazing space for me to test my business and entrepreneurial chops to figure out how do we apply this technology that's currently in the innovation space. For me, yeah, I agree with you. Another opportunity for building for everyone. I'll say, for example, there's a headset. I'm not gonna name it, but there's a headset that there was a time where I would, you know, have my hair up in a pineapple, which is like a very common style for women with my hair. But there's like a strap going across the middle of it, and so with my giant ponytail on top, I could not wear that headset. And I'm like, I don't know. People have top knots. People have buns. Like, I guess this headset is not for me. And you can see the design or the shift towards, hey, what about a glasses type thing, which is already ergonomically kind of designed to fit more face types, have more flexibility, is kind of what things have transitioned to. Or even the ID, the industrial design of devices are changing to ensure that they do reach a broader market share. But again, even more opportunities for social impact, like during the pandemic, when we were very isolated, leaning into VR as an opportunity to again connect with people around the world from the safety of my home. I went to comedy shows. I shared some of my own poetry during Black History Month in the US online with people, around the world who were hungry for that type of content during this time of social unrest. So it's kind of amazing for me to jump in and really, like I said, get excited, get passionate about what are the new opportunities for connection or what new problems are there out there to kind of solve in this new space. But also have some career challenges for me, like working in enterprise versus in consumer, to continue to challenge myself.
Got it. So if we talk about that kind of for everybody, so and here's a bit of a vocal one. I'm gonna name drop, but in a good way, not in a bad way, because I don't want to talk specific about them, but I think it's important to give that context. So we've mentioned obviously I suppose Microsoft and by virtue I suppose HoloLens and Xbox. Who else have you worked for in the kind of the big tech space, just so we get that right?
So I've been at Microsoft. I've been, at Meta, Facebook at the time, working in both hardware and software. I did a stint at SoftBank Robotics America, which was my first time working on with an international organization. We were making humanoid robots to kind of help with in the service space, in the service robot, not necessarily personal care. And now I'm over at Alphabet, working in a new bet called Everyday Robots. So I've been all around, working in lots of different spaces, but I will say that, while I've made lots of different hops, kind of the principles that guide what I work on and how I work on and how I value and prioritize users and make decisions as a product manager kind of stay consistent even as I learn and grow. But yeah, it's been great to be at a diversity of places.
And the reason why I wanted to ask that, and I think it's relevant, because it comes on to kind of my next question, which is about that building stuff for everyone. And I think it's fair to say that the way that tech has developed over time hasn't necessarily always done that. And you have those tensions between wanting to make sure that your products are for everybody, because look, all the companies you mentioned and many more, they're all global businesses. Do you know what I mean? Everyone's a potential customer. So you can't really exclude anyone, because do you know what I mean? Everywhere you look, there's money kind of left on the table. But for a lot of product managers, they don't have the resources of an Alphabet or a Microsoft or a Meta. And there are some of the trade-offs that they make. The market might not be this big, because the product or thing might be niche, and that's fine. It might move from a $1 trillion market to a $100 billion market, still huge, but do you know what I mean? In itself, maybe maybe a different type of battle. How do you reflect on like the resource constraint thing? Now obviously reflecting in your work, where I suppose you're in a smaller entity than maybe some of the bigger ones that you've been to.
So for me, there's a lot of intention behind what is built, or I believe that there should be. And there's opportunities sometimes when you're in early stage projects to do research, to understand what are the opportunities in the market. Sometimes you do want to start in a niche and really, differentiate yourself and anchor in this group. Or sometimes you do want to go mainstream, but these are intentional decisions that businesses have to make when they're understanding these trade-offs. For me, let's say you decide to go mainstream, you're doing something that you think is broad reaching and you understand users at a certain level. And you launch some use cases or you launch a set of features that are out there. I think that's just the beginning of the journey, and maybe your V1 isn't built for absolutely everyone because, like you said, you are resource constrained. You have to get some MVP out there in the hands of people so that you can get feedback. But it's critical that once you get that feedback, that you decide what to do with it, right? You can have an opportunity where, okay, there's a season of your development process where you are fixing bugs, leaning in, supporting those folks that you originally invested in. But then, hopefully, if the funding is right, if the investment from that first release is successful, that you can make a roadmap and a plan to expand and say, hey, not only is this just not working, it's not working for this whole community, and here's why. And then, use that creative energy and those juices to expand beyond that, right? So when I wrote in saying like, hey, here's a photo of me trying to use your headset and it doesn't work, like, and I'm not expecting them to go and create something that retrofits every version of the hardware moving backwards, so just so I can use it. But I am saying in the future, as you make your V1 or sorry, your V2 or your V3, think about that, know about that. But if you're only ever looking at white men with short hair, who never, you're never going to find that new problem in that new space. So it has been awesome to be able to go to different conferences, to go like yours, right? And interact and have people give feedback and say, this is why this is not for me. I think that negative feedback is so valuable to open our eyes to being inclusive. But I will say that if you have that intention in the beginning, you're a product manager, that you can pursue and know and intentionally design a roadmap that does allow you to expand without feeling the overwhelmingness that, oh, I have to hit every single persona on day zero.
So let's zoom into your work that you do right now. Robots, everyday robots, as you mentioned. I mean, for those who are a bit less familiar, I suppose, let us know obviously what the mission is about. But let me throw this out there. A lot of people have said, really dystopian things about, robots are gonna take over. They're going to, kill off all of the jobs that people have. They're gonna be the downfall of society, and we're all gonna be subjects of their orders in generations to come. How true is that? I mean, for someone who's working on
Yeah.
it, help me understand how everyday will robots be.
No, valid concerns, valid concerns. So we're a new group, Everyday Robots, and I won't speak too much about what we're doing because it's very, very early stage, but our goal really is to make robots that are helpful, that can help people in their everyday lives. And these are learning robots. These aren't robots that are just like hard-coded programmed to do one thing like you might see in a factory, but they're learning and trying to understand the world just like we are as everyday people. But I think those concerns about how technology is going to impact the way that we work and just the way that society evolves is true. Whether we're talking about robots or websites or mobile apps, we've seen this. We've seen, wars be fought, all across the web. And so, when I'm thinking about being in this industry, I take it as a responsibility, right? To be intentional about the ethical decisions that we're making, how we're trying to keep things both private and keep people safe as they interact with these devices, right? We think a lot about human-robot interaction and how to bridge this gap. The term that comes to me is like that social acceptance, right? How do we make people feel safe and comfortable? Because if people don't feel safe and comfortable, it doesn't matter how great this robot might be at cleaning, at doing whatever it's going to do. If you always feel uncomfortable around it, then that's just not going to be a great product market fit. It's my honor to be there to know, like, hey, these robots should be useful, but they should also be respected, right? We shouldn't be going around kicking these things or treating them as like a lesser being in society because they are of service to us. What I see them as is the opportunity to unlock potential, to take away work that we don't enjoy doing or that we don't excel at doing. The trend in the industry is to really focus on dull, dirty, or dangerous tasks that put people at risk. But there's also a thoughtfulness that I can bring as a product manager, and even designing how you interact with these things and the jobs that we create in terms of maintaining, deploying, and even developing new opportunities for them. Yeah, I hope that answered your question. There's so much to cover there, but like I said, being in that space, being thoughtful about how people feel and react, like this is not a thing where we can just put it out there and hope people will get used to it over time. It's something that we have to be thoughtful about integrating into human spaces, just like we would do any technology, but also thinking about how people will interact with these devices and putting some really deep thought into that as well.